Good evening. As many of you will no doubt recall, there's a lovely tradition at this time of the year before midnight mass on Christmas of singing what's called the Christmas Proclamation. It comes to us from the ancient Roman martyrology and is a dating of the Christmas event, the incarnation event, from different calendars and events in history. It serves primarily to situate our Lord's birth in historical time, in the year of creation, the year after the flood, the year of the reign of Caesar Augustus, the foundation of the city of Rome. It's a wonderful reminder of the historical reality of the incarnation, that it happened in such and such a year, at such and such a place, in such and such a time. And I will now hopefully give a good chanting of this proclamation to put us in our hearts and minds before God, before this Holy Mass this evening.
Octavo calendas Januari luna vigesima prima anno a creatione mundi. Quando in principio Deus creavi caelum et terram, quinquies est millesimo centesimo nonagesimo nono, adiluvio autem, anno bis millesimo nongentesimo quinquagesimo septimo, a nativitate abre, anno bis millesimo quintodecimo, a Moesi et egressu populi Israeli Egypto, anno millesimo quincentesimo decimo, ab unctione David in regem, anno millesimo trigesimo secundo, hebdomada sexigesima quinta, iuxta Danielis profetiam, olympiade centesima nonagesima quarta, ab orbe Roma condita, anno septingesimo quinquagesimo secundo, anno imperii Octaviani Augusti, quadragesimo secundo, toto orbe in pace composito, sexta mundi etate, Iesus Christus, eternus Deus etenique Patris Filius, mundum volens adventus suo pissimo consecrare, de Spiritu Sancto conceptus, novemque post conceptionem de quosus mensibus, in Bethlehem iure nascitor ex Maria Virgine factus homo, nativitas Domini nostri Jesu Christi, secundum carnem.
Christi illustratione clarescere, da quae sumus, ut cuius lucis mysteria in terra coniovimus, eius quoque gaudis in celu perfruamur, qui te cum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Lectio Epistolae Beati Pauli Apostoli ad Titum. Carissime, apparuit gratia Dei Salvatoris nostri omnibus hominibus, ed urientos ut abnegantes in pietatem et secularia desideria, sobrie et iuste pie vivamus in hoc saeculo, expectantes beatam spem, et adventum gloriae mani Dei et salvatoris nostri Iesu Christi, qui dedit sem et ipsum pro nobis, ut nos redimeret ab omni iniquitate, et mundaret sibi populum acceptabilem, sectatorem bonorum operum. Hic loquere et exhortare in Christo Iesu Domino nostro.
Thank you. Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sequentia sancti evangelii secundum Lucam.
Gloria tibi, Domine.
In illo tempore, exit edictum a Caesare Augusto descripere universus orbis. Hic descriptio prima facta est a preside Sirie Sirino, et ibant omnes ut profiterentur singuli in suam civitatem. Ascendit autem ad Iosef a Galilee de civitate Nazareth. In Judeam in civitatem David, quae vocator Bethlehem, eo cor essete domo et familia David. Ut profiteretur cum Maria disponsata sibi uxore pregnante. Factum est autem cum essentivi, in pleti sunt Iesut pareret, et peperit filium sum primogenitum, et panis eum involvit, et reclinavit eum in praesepio, quia non erat eis locus in derversorio, et pastores erant in regione earem vigilantes, et custodientes vigilias noctis super gregem suum. Et ecce angelus Domini stetit iuxte illo, et claritas Dei circumfusit illos, et temuerunt timore manio, et dixit illis angelus, nolite timere, et cenime vagelitso vobis gaudium manium, quod erit omni populo, quia natus et vobis hodie salvator, qui es Christus Dominus in civitate David. Et hoc vobis, Signum, invenietis infantem panis involutum, et positum in praesepio. Et subito facta est cum angelum multitudo militia celestis, laudantium Deum, et dicentium gloriae altissimis Deo. Et in terra pax hominibus bone voluntatis.
Merry Christmas, and just a few announcements. What were my announcements? Besides Merry Christmas, I just wanted to say a word about the altar rail. That we're planning to put in an altar rail, and we got a new estimate. Originally, I was thinking it was going to be expensive, but we got a new estimate. It's going to be about $70,000 to $90,000 to put in a beautiful brass altar rail with a wood top, which will match the tabernacle, the one we'll put in its proper place, and a wood top to sort of match the wood in the church. And so it'll be very beautiful. But we have a good start on the fundraising, but if anybody feels on their heart that they can give or has the means to give, certainly please contact me. We do need more funds for that. So thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Every year we encounter the same reality. The lights in the Christmas tree go up. We prepare for Christmas. We have the Christmas pageants and hear the Christmas story. And we recall the real meaning of Christmas, you know, pulling ourselves away from just the secularization and realizing that we're here to celebrate the Christ child. And then the Christmas story comes to us just sort of as we know, you know, Jesus, Mary and Joseph traveling to Bethlehem, etc. And yet, even though we've heard it so many times, if we pause and think about it, the Christmas story is totally unlike anything we have ever heard in our lives. And if it is true, it changes everything, everything. So a virgin conceived a son. Joseph was not the father. God was the father. While 9 months pregnant, Mary and Joseph traveled by foot and donkey over 90 miles from Nazareth to Bethlehem. In a cave used as a stable on the outskirts of the city, she gave birth. And there, surrounded by the animals, some shepherds came to adore the child. And this is the beginning of the most important event in history. This is the central moment in which God came into the world. God became a little child. But we have to ask the question, why? Because that is a bold claim. God became a little child. And we have to re-realize the boldness of that claim. The world needs to re-realize the boldness of that claim. Why? Who can believe such a thing? Look at the world around you. Look at the suffering in the world and the stormy times that we live in. Look at these two past years and how much they've upset the world. Look at our own lives. Look at what's going on in the church. Look at the hardships we face every day. Wouldn't we rather escape from this? Why would God enter into it? We should say, no, God, don't come here. This is not where we want to be. Maybe just find a way to make us come to you. Perhaps we've heard the story of the farmer and the geese. The story goes back a few years. So it was Christmas Eve, and a man came home after an exhausting day, only to be met by his wife, who was leaving with the children to go to Christmas Mass. And he knew his wife was devout. She was raising the kids Catholic, and he was generally a good man, good husband, but he couldn't help feeling so frustrated. He couldn't possibly believe all this stuff about Christmas, God becoming man. Yes, it was nice and all, but why would Jesus become one of us? Wasn't all this church going either madness or just sentimentalism, trying to escape from the hard facts of reality? He said he would stay home and get some things done. He noticed after they left that the wind started picking up and a real winter storm rolled in. Church wasn't far, so he wasn't worried about them getting there and back safely, so he sat down to his reading. And all of a sudden he heard a thump on the window, quickly followed by another and then another. So he donned his coat and his boots and walked out into the storm. And what met his eyes was the wind was howling around him, and he made out this flock of geese that were in his back pasture. They were in disarray, flying around in low circles, being buffeted by the wind. Some had even blown into the windows of the house, and that was made the loud thumping sounds. So they were on their way south when the storm hit, and he knew enough about the weather where he was to know that they would not survive outside all night in the wind and the snow. So he walked over to his barn. He threw open the doors of the barn, and he turned on the light and tried to attract them, tried to get their attention to come into the barn. They still kept milling about, so he tried sort of ushering them in, herding them into the barn. But every time he approached them, they would run away. They would scatter because they feared him. He tried calling to them and then tried driving them into the barn. He then thought maybe he could lure them in with food, so he made a little trail of breadcrumbs into the barn, but to no avail. Every time he came close, they scattered. He began to get frustrated. If he didn't get them into that barn that night, they would not survive. Why wouldn't they just go? He ran after them again and again, but more half-heartedly each time. Hopelessness finally set in. If only they knew that he was there to help them. If only he was a goose and could show them the way into the barn. He thought to himself, if only I were one of them, I could save them. He cried in exasperation. He had barely uttered the words when above the wind he heard loud and clear the church bell tolling. He stood still listening to the bells and the first words of Adeste Fidelis. And there in the snow, he sank to his knees for the first time. God became one of us to show us the way. He entered into his creation in order to convince us that he is trustworthy. We do not have a God that is distant from us, but involved in every aspect of our lives. Now, the story about the farmer and the geese does a good job of showing that God became man to show us a way out. But that's not the end of the story. Even if the farmer had been able to become a goose, the other geese would have just remained geese. He would have been able to share their life, but there would be nothing he could do to show them what it meant to be a human being. When God became man, he did so in order to transform our lives, in order to offer us something that seems impossible. It's impossible even to say, for a human being to share in his divine life. Our Father does not send his Son into the world to then show us into the barn or an outhouse. He sent his Son into the world to bring us into his home, into his house, a house built for his beloved sons and daughters, the house which is the church, built on the rock of Peter, and being able to withstand every storm through every century, no matter what. When we entered the church, we did so from the stormy darkness. We were greeted with the ritual washing of water, which was the sign of a covenant formed between us and the owner of the house. We were given a share and considered part of his household. This house now belongs to us. As we made our way into the home, we realized with astonishment all of the times we had run from the son of the house, not trusting that he was there to help us, to save us. Seeing our sinfulness, he takes it from us with the words, "I absolve you," in the sacrament of confession, and then leads us to the banquet hall. There he feeds us by unfolding for us the whole meaning of our being, everything we are. He's the only one who can show us that, and revealing to us the way to live free from sin, and promising to be there to pick us up every time we fall. He then offers us the love of his heart and his very self in the Eucharist, because he knows we need the strength. All of this began on the darkest night of the year, originally the winter solstice. And while the world was dark and the howling wind made it a land of gloom, as we hear from the Isaiah the prophet, a small light appeared in the stable of Bethlehem, a light that attracted the poorest shepherds and the most learned kings, but the most learned kings who were willing to follow a star, a light that began to grow and illuminate the world, a light that is given and offered to us, but this light can only be seen by those who are willing to see it and receive it. So many people I speak with like the idea of the light. They think it's nice, but they won't give themselves to feel its warmth. Sadly, in our world, the secular lights of moral relativism, busyness, and apathy keep so many bound in their seductive chains. Young people I know encounter these things every single day, at school, amidst their own peers. We have to ask ourselves, why do we want to remain shackled by the things of this world, by the teachings of this world? Where is there a way out? So many people have forsaken true worship of the Creator of the universe. First Sunday Mass goes, then estrangement from the teachings of Jesus Christ passed on through his church, then we feel estranged from God. Then we have to look after ourselves. Why? Because we don't believe that God will look after us. We have to create meaning instead of entering into it. This creates the busyness and anxiety over what we need to do and trying to be happy according to our own way. We have to create our own world. But with this also comes fear, great fear. Fear which keeps us crippled where we are, and ironically, apathy grows. So many in our world are like the geese running deeper into the storm from the hands that are trying to help them. But to the light of the world, and this is the importance of the incarnation, to the light of the world, to God made man, our darkness and our shabbiness just becomes a greater invitation for his saving hand. That is the hope that is offered to us. While we were yet in sin, God became man. If we turn toward the light, we will find that God has a face, and not the face of a tyrant seeking revenge, nor the face of one who is mighty and imposing, but in this coming, he comes with the face of a child, coming in humility, reaching out a hand to touch our lives. And if this baby is human, he knows my condition. He knows what I need and that I long for peace. And if this baby is divine, then he can free me from my sins and he can bring peace into my soul because he is the Prince of Peace. Lord, we long to see your face. Enter the poor stables of our souls this evening and fill it with your unending light. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sorsam corda.
Adeus ad Dominum.
Gratias agamus Domino Deo nostro.
Dignum et justum est.
Pere dignum et justum est et cum et salutare. Nos tibi semper et ubique gratias agere. Domine Sancte Pater Omnipotens Eterne Deus, quia per incarnati verbi mysterium, nova mentis nostre oculis lux tuae claritatis infusit, ut tum visibiliter Deum coniosimus, per hunc in invisibilium amorem rapiamo, et ideo cum angelis et arcangelis, cum tronis et dominationibus, cumque omni militiae celestis exercitus, hymnum gloriae tuae canimus, sine fine dicente.
Dominis proque peccatoribus.
Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Oremus. Precepti salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere. Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum. Adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum, da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris. Et ne nos inducas in tentationem.
Sed libera nos a malo.
Thank you.
Dei, executuli peccata mundi, Domine, in nos
sentimus, et respectem me, sed tanti creo et sanatoria mea. Domine, in nos sentimus, et respectem me, sed tanti creo et sanatoria mea. Domine, in nos sentimus, et respectem me, sed tanti creo et sanatoria mea.
Amen. Domine Deus Noster, ut qui nativitatem Domini Nostri Jesu Christi, mysteriis nos frequentare gaudemus, dignis conversationibus areus meriamur pervenire consortium, qui te convivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et spiritu tuo.
Ite missa est.
Deo gratias.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum. Initium Sancti Evangelii secundum Ioannem. In principio erat verbum, et verbum erat apud Deum, et Deus erat verbum. Hoc erat in principio apud Deum. Omnia per ipsum facta sunt, et sine ipso factum est nihil quod factum est. In ipso vita erat, et vita erat lux hominum, et lux in tenebris lucet, et tenebrae eam non comprenderum. Huit homum Iisus ad Deo cui nomen erat Ioannes, hic venit in testimonium, ut testimonium pereberet illumine, ut omnes credent per illum. Non erat ille lux, sed ut testimonium pereberet illumine. Erat lux vera, qui illuminat omnem hominem venientem in hoc mundum. In mundo erat, et mundus per ipsum factus est, et mundus eam non coniovit. In propria venit, et sui eam non receperunt. Quod autem receperunt eum, dedit eis potestatem filius Dei fieri. His, qui credunt in nomine eius, qui non ex sanguinibus, neque ex voluntate carnis, neque ex voluntate viri, sed ex Deo nati sunt. Et verbum caro factum est. Et habitabit in nobis, et vidimus gloriam eius, gloriam quasi unigenitia Patre, plenum gratiae et veritatis.